soccer officials, welcome back to the basic UNCW rules for outdoor soccer. Again, my name is Andy Ramp, and I'm the coordinator of competitive sports, and I'm going to walk you through some of these rules that we have for outdoor soccer. So the first things first, you always need a UNCW ID in order to play. This may not necessarily pertain to you when you're out at the field, but when the students come in and they want to check in with you, or they may want to check in with you, you need to send them back to the building to let them know that they need to check in there. Typically, our supervising staff does a great job of catching them before they even walk through, and they have them sign in. But if they ask you, they need a UNCW ID to play. A driver's license does not work. Facebook profile, Instagram profile, that doesn't work. So we need to make sure we have that. And it pertains to every student, faculty, and staff member that wants to come play here. Just because they're your chemistry professor doesn't mean that you can let them slide and play without showing their ID. If they're your best friend, unfortunately, they still need their ID as well. So we need to make sure we're consistent on that policy. So some of the illegal equipment that we have new to this year is that jewelry is permitted as long as it's not deemed harmful by you or our supervising staff. So what this pertains to, if somebody's wearing a smooth wedding ring or a smooth ring, they can have that. The Livestrong bracelets or anything like that, they can have those. Studded earrings, as long as they're not protruding out, they're fine. Nose rings or eyebrow rings, as long as they're deemed that you deem that they're not harmful, we're going to allow them. Now, if a participant comes out with a big hooped earring, that's not going to be allowed. We're going to make them take it off. Any sort of watch they're going to have to take off. It could be an Apple Watch or a fitness tracker or just a regular old digital watch. They got to take those off, so we're going to make sure that we don't do that. Things that we don't allow is no hats allowed to play in intramural sports for at least outdoor soccer. And they must have closed-toed shoes. They can have cleats, that's all right. And they must wear athletic attire, so no jeans, no khakis, anything of that nature. So if they want to play, athletic attire, and they have to have closed-toed shoes. If they do wear cleats, they got to make sure that they are rubber with no metal tips whatsoever with them. And all of our games for outdoor soccer are played at the recreation field complex. So that's where we're going to play everything for outdoor soccer. For our scorecards, which you'll see popped up here, things that we need to be filled out are the date, time, and the field. Those are going to be filled out for you already. The team name's already going to be filled in there for you as well. Our staff in the office should take care of that. If not, go ahead and fill it in. But what you'll need to do is make sure that you put in their team color. So we may have teal and navy, we may have red and blue, we may have yellow and green, whatever it is. You just make sure you fill that out. And then you'll need to fill out the scores for each half. So if they score a goal, you just put a tally mark. Score another goal, tally mark. You keep going until the half is over. And then you do the same thing for the second half. Once we do that, we'll total the scores. So in this case, we have Seahawks 4, Team Teal with 7. And then we put the final. New this year, we are not doing sportsmanship ratings. So regardless how good or bad our teams are, we're not doing sportsmanship. So you can put that in there for notes. But the other thing you need to make sure you do is putting any unsportsmanlike cards or any trouble players that you may have. So if we do have any cards, so here we have for Team Seahawk, we have a verbal assent. So maybe they swore at you, maybe they called you a name, and you gave them a red card and ejected them. So we put that here. We will also need to fill out that proper incident report, so we make sure that we do that. If we ever fill out an incident report, and I know we're going to cover this a little bit later, we need to put as much information in there as we can. So if they told you were the worst effing official ever, write that down for me. They followed you back to the building, write that down for me. Multiple people started shouting at you from the sidelines. I want to know that, so we can make sure that we have as much information as we can when we meet with these students. The second one was a slide without contact, which is a yellow card. So we would just put that in there. Slide no contact, slide with contact would be a red, and we'd put that in there, and then we'd make sure that we have them properly ejected. And then at the bottom, you'll fill in your names of you and your partner, so I know who actually officiated this game. We've done a really good job over the years to make sure that all this information is filled out, and then you will turn this back into the supervisor who's working in the building, signing people in, so we can make sure we transfer those over. If you have any questions about the scorecard, you need to make sure you ask our supervisors prior to you going out there. For us, we play with 9 players. So we play 9v9, and we can start with as few as 6. And we'll go over our ratios for CoRec here in just a little bit. But as long as we have 6 on each team, we can go ahead and play. And then we will do a coin toss. with the visiting captain calling the toss, so it'll be denoted on your score sheet. So if you do this, you look at the visiting captain. If you happen to have a coin, you flip the coin. If not, you do an odd or even. You put that behind your back. You look at the visiting captain, and you say one or two, odd or even, with the other captain behind you. And the reason we do this is so this captain knows you're not cheating for this team. So you put that behind him. They guess. You show them what it is. And then they have the option of kicking off, receiving, or defending a goal. And then we give them the other option. Timing for outdoor soccer is 2 20-minute halves. They run continuously without stopping unless we have an injury or an official's timeout. And there's a 5-minute halftime. If the game is tied at the end of regulation, we're going to have a 5-person shootout. And this is new for this year. So if it is still tied, the process will be repeated. We will have 5 shooters. We don't go to sudden death. So we will always have 5 shooters. They can keep the same shooters, or they can switch the shooters up. And they can have it in any order that they want. And we'll talk about co-rec here in just a little bit. The mercy rule for us is 4 more goals at the 2-minute mark. So if there's 2 minutes or less remaining, we go ahead and stop the game. If at any point the margin becomes 4 more during that time, we stop it immediately. If it's 1 or 2 or 3, we have to continue playing. For us, substitutions can happen an unlimited number of times during any of the following situation: between periods, so at halftime, on goal kicks, corner kicks, throw-ins, when a goal is scored, when a player is injured that needs to be attending to, meaning you stop the clock, or if there's a disqualified player, meaning that we have an ejected player and they need to leave the field. So if any team wants to substitute at any given time, they need to come to midfield and be beckoned on by the official. Our teams are going to be on the opposite ends of the field, so one team's going to be on this side and one team's going to be on this sideline. So if they have a sub, they're going to go to midfield. Hey, I want to sub in as soon as the ball goes dead, and they come to you. If they sub on the fly, the player coming in gets an automatic yellow card if you don't bring them in during live ball. So if the ball goes out, they say sub, and they happen to walk on, and the other team's walking off, and you notice it, and there's no delay in play, we'll go with it. But if play is going up and down the field and players just walk on and off the field, it's an automatic yellow card to the player who came on the field, because we don't sub on the fly. It has to come through you. So we need to make sure that we're vigilant of that, that we're always looking at midfield. This is also a good thing that you want to talk about in your captain's meeting. So if you're like, hey, if you got subs, send them to midfield. Take a step out. Hey, I want a sub. They'll come out and want a sub. You beckon them on and off. What we don't want to do is towards the end of the game, when it's starting to get down to crunch time, that they sub on and they take a really, really long time to get off the field. What we're going to make sure is that if we do have that sub come on, hustle off, go off one end of the field, whatever it is. But if they start walking off, stop the clock, say, I'm going to wait for you to get off the field, and then we're going to continue play. And if they're like, well, this is just soccer, no, that's not soccer. We need to make sure that the game is progressing at a good clip. If they want to sub and they want to jog on and off, that's fine. But what we're not going to do is every time that ball goes out of bounds, we have a sub to delay time. We will stop the clock and we will make sure that the team that is down gets the right amount of time to play. The differences for co-rec for us is we still play 9-on-9. However, you need a maximum of 5 players of one gender and a max of 4 of the other. So that gets us to our 9. If you're starting a game with less than 9, so a team has to have a minimum of 6, you can have no more than 5 and a minimum of 2. So that's our gender ratio. You can't play 5-1, but you can play 5-2 or 4-2 to get to that 6. So any combination of a minimum of 2, maximum of 5, well, you can play. If they don't have anybody from the other gender, they're not going to be able to play that game. So we need to make sure that they have minimum of 2, maximum of 5. And anybody can be the goalkeeper when it comes to this. So if they want to stick somebody from the least numbered gender in goal and have everybody else on the field, that's fine. We just need to make sure that those gender ratios are kept. If people show up as the game progresses, they have to wait till a dead ball to be beckoned in. They can't just run in on the field. That's not how this is played. They need to go to midfield. You bring them in. The other thing we have for co-rec differences is that the fire player shootout doesn't have a gender order anymore. So they choose 5 players to shoot. It doesn't matter if it's 5 males, 5 females, 4-1, 2-3, 3-2, whatever it is. If the second shootout is needed, the team can choose the same 5 players to shoot, or they can pick a new 5, or a combination, and they can change it up. Again, gender does not matter. We're trying to be as inclusive as we can on this. Thank you for watching the opening part of UNCW Outdoor Soccer Rules. We will come back after you take your test with the next set of blended learning modules.